Hello, everybody, and welcome to a little episode of Jack Wall Flying Flight Simulator X. And today we've got a little bit of a flight plan that we're going to fly from the Marathon airport in the Florida Keys. And we're going to fly that out to Nassau in the Bahamas. And we're taking this aircraft here, which is a Cessna 208, C208. So I'll bring you back in a moment once I get set up inside and we sort out a few little details. Kind of feels like we're not. That would be because we don't actually have the nav button set. And now we will turn back onto that. That was the flight director yaw damper and control, so we're good. A little bit of a gentle climb coming up, and we're basically going to follow a lot of the road on the way out. So we'll turn off that. What else have we got here? Our taxi recognition lights, we'll leave those on. Strobe is on, nav is on, beacon is on. Generators are on, fuel is looking good, everything else is up here in the okay. And we'll just turn down the cockpit noise just ever so a little bit as we fly out over the South Floridian Keys on our way to the Bahamas. I'm running Rex weather today, and apparently this is the weather today, or was the weather this morning. I don't know if that's the case or if that's true or not, but we do have some cloud base that is probably on the 5,000 mark, so for interest and fun we might just choose to stay below that now. 4,500 might be appropriate. We can run on that quite nicely. So this is, this is how it is. Just getting my position set up there a little bit more easy to get onto all of the pieces of information here. Have the throttle running a little bit there for some reason. I'm not convinced I understand why that is. But we are climbing relatively nicely here. And we have a little bit of turbulence that we're picking up as well by the same things. Fuel boost is on. Well, we don't really need that on, so we will turn that off. Prop de-ice. It's not a bad idea to turn that on, given that we're going to be need to slow down a little bit here now, otherwise we're going to the throttle is still not set up correctly, otherwise we're going to overspeed aircraft, and that's not good. What's the wind doing here? Wind is kind of not really hurting us too much. It's slowing us down a little bit, but let's push that back up to about 1700. If I can get it to stabilize around the 1700 mark. Or not. Yeah, this is something that I need to work on. What I was going to do is get down here, and I was going to turn on my prop heater and anti-ice. I was going to turn on all of those. That's just going to keep things a little bit nicer and less concerning there. So that cloud base was around about 3,000, and we're punching up into it, so we might as well punch up above it, I guess. Although, if it's broken cloud, then we'll be able to see little bits and pieces below us, and if it's not broken cloud, then obviously we're not going to see anything. So just running that back up to the 5.5 that we said we'd fly at, and we're still only pulling 500 feet a minute, so it's a relatively gentle climb. We could probably improve on that, couldn't we? 750 feet a minute, 1775 on the torque. So I don't think we're going to be overtaxing the engine here. Everything looks like it's in the green, and we're running a fuel flow of 356 pounds per hour. Flight time so far is 7 minutes and 27 seconds, and everything else is looking fairly good. I don't think there's anything I've forgotten. No? Everything is okay up there. So this is one of these flights that we're just going to run and take a time on and try and work out some fuel burn and just verify that the route makes sense. We can see the route as it's showing up here. In fact, let me just get over onto that with this view. So we've already passed VPLYY. We're on to M8 right now, which is another 11.3 nautical miles away. So we kind of started off at 9:26, and we're expected to arrive straight in at 10:33. That's kind of the calculated ETA at the moment if we stay flying this route without any deviations or significant changes in weather or anything else. So that's kind of an hour and 7 minutes is what we're kind of slated for, and we'll see what the actual time is with the timer reference that I've done. So these things are pretty good. And aside from my setting up my initial starting position with this flight planning malarkey, once I do the direct to, and then I can kind of add in the flight plan after that, with the direct to the first waypoint, then I seem to be able to kind of create it and achieve it. It's not perhaps the right way of doing things, but it is the way we're doing it. Getting up to 5,500, so we're going to level off here, and we'll pick up a little bit more speed, which will probably change that ETA a little bit, because we won't be climbing at 150 knots or less anymore. We're just going to have to keep an eye on the speed so that we don't overcook it. So we have heading nav, which is either the radio nav or the GPS, which is what we're using right now. And then we kind of just select our altitude and away we go. And takeoff torque settings are below 1865. The air conditioner must be off for takeoff and landing. And we are below 1865, we're 1759. Kind of going to just nudge that a little bit more so that we get up to about 1850 or so. See what that does, but we're going to burn past 1850 here. Where will it stop? Nobody knows. 1865, 1866 or so. That's not too bad. That's just going to bring our speed up closer to the 170 mark, which is going to help us make a little bit of progress. What that does mean is that our ETA has come down to just 1 minute over the hour now. Currently, so these are the changes that occur. Outside on the scenery, we've got the OpenLC land class from FTX Orbix, North America, on top of Global, on top of Mesh, on top of Vectors. I'm not 100% convinced that I have it set up correctly. Maybe I have. there's a couple of things that are catching my attention here and there, which kind of suggests to me that there's some other land classes that have still got precedence and they're showing through. Although that doesn't look shockingly terrible down there right now, to be honest with you. It's a little bit more believable than earlier when I was flying out of another location. I had a lot of bleed through of different sceneries that I recognized from before. And they're not the right sceneries to have, so I think I might have a few sceneries that I shouldn't have still in the list, and it's a case of trying to find them and weed them out, to be honest with you, which is easy to say and not so easy to do. Airspeed has got stabilized now at around about 165 indicated, which is not too shabby. Ground speed of just under 200 knots, which is not too shabby either. Current time in the day is down here at 9:33 with an ETA of, that's just to the next track, of 14 minutes. So. We're doing fairly okay. And I've decided that I would track the route fairly close to the Keys, and then rather than follow it up toward Miami. Actually, we can see it here on the display quite nicely, so we might as well use it. So you can see where we are now. We're just passing M8, and this is where I'm going to branch off and head out towards Skips, which is just coming in on screen here right now. We can close that away temporarily. I could have tracked up here the Miami coast and cut across a little bit more, but I kind of figured that rather than do that, we would just use Junior and pop over to Skips, and at 5,000 feet, maybe we're not really high enough if we did have a problem to be able to glide back, so maybe the idea is that we should climb a little bit higher during this part of the cruise. And actually, I'm going to make that decision, so we're just going to cruise up to 9,500, and we will turn on our vertical speed and give ourselves a little bit more, like 700 feet per minute climb, just to try and get that to come back. That's probably a little bit more sensible. So 9,005 is what we'll select. I'll make a note of that so I can put it into the flight plan. 9,500. That means that if we did have any trouble, we'd have a little bit of more altitude to play with, to afford us the ability to get back, hopefully to land, on land and not on the water. Fuel-wise, we might need to be taking a little bit more fuel as well. I'm just looking at the rate at which we're burning our fuel. So we've gone up to 371 pounds per hour right now. If we go and have a look here, we're down to 288, 517 remaining. In fact, I'll put that on the other screen because we don't need the fuel flow showing on both. This is, you know, something to be aware of. We've used 109 right now. We've got quite a bit to do still. I think we're okay on fuel, but we're not going to be able to just turn around and fly back, that's for sure. So we might need to do a bit more on our fuel calculation. In fact, I've done no fuel calculations here at all. I've just taken whatever was defaulted in the plane. So that's a recipe for disaster right there, of course. That's the beauty of a flight sim as well, though. You don't have to take it so seriously because you can't be hurt. It's also one of the curses of the flight sim. Minus 3 degrees outside temperature, so sticking our little anti-ice on is probably no harm. sure if I'm seeing ice build up or not there. We're kind of staying out of the clouds mostly. And I don't know how well that's modeled either. There'd be a certain amount of that would be cool if that indeed was modeled. But not convinced it is. That's it, really. We're just going to tick along here on this flight. You're going to stay with me. It will be the opportunity, I suppose, for you to just jump through the video. Maybe I might put a note in there if you wanted to skip through some of this section here and get to the landing phase later on. Basically, this is going to be it. We're climbing up through 8,495, so we're climbing fairly well, actually. We're getting a decent bit of altitude here now. We are kind of in visual of landmass still over there, although we are going away from it. We do have some islands up in front of us as well, but they're quite a bit away. Our best option at the moment would be to sacrifice a little bit of altitude, but try and make it turn over to our 9 or 10 o'clock and see if we can put down over there if it came that. Okay. Right, whole load of stuff going on about Cliffs of Dover, another flight sim that I fly a lot of with 54 Squadron on Storm of War, and as of today, the 23rd of August 2016, after many, many years, not one, two, or three, but like five or six, there's been an update that has turned up on Steam from whoever has the source code officially for IL-2 Cliffs of Dover, which on the very simple terms of it, turn on compatibility with Windows 8. There's a storm of reaction to this, such that very quickly the developers put in an option where via the Steam interface you could turn off your update, basically, and revert back to whatever you had before. For some reason, this did affect me, even though I'm running Windows 7. Thankfully, I don't think the install happened. But it was set to update, and I unclicked it and took it off. I sometimes don't understand. Steam just runs automatic updates, and it's probably something that I did and I wasn't aware of doing it. I'm not really sure. But anyway, no damage done. But I did check into the forums, and there are quite a few people that have been crying wolf over this update because it was breaking their ability to play on Windows 10, which a lot of folks had gone on to. Much discussion is going on about the Team Fusion patches. Now, Team Fusion is a group of individuals who, back in the day, well, after this thing was released, broken and pitiful, they set about trying to recover the title such that it is what it is today, a very successful flight sim in its own right, and one that is really rather pretty in terms of aesthetics, and it's fairly accomplished as well in the scheme of things. However, development did kind of come to a grinding halt. and a lot of folks, having spent money on it, were left with a lemon. Team Fusion did come along and turn that lemon into something a lot sweeter. And we have Team Fusion patch 4, effectively, that has been released. It's been 3 or 4 patches that have got up to patch 4. There was patch 2, patch 2.1 or something, and a patch 3 and a patch 4. And indeed, Team Fusion patch 5 has been on the go for the last couple of years. It hasn't released. I don't know if it's actually ever going to release. That's, you know, a lot of folks are kind of waiting for Team Fusion patch 5 because it offers another injection of lifeblood into the title. So as of today's update, I noticed something that I don't know was there before, and an end user license agreement which is showing up on Steam. Yeah, I'm sure that this existed before. I just hadn't noticed it, or when I did skim read it, I didn't record anything of merit in there, the usual blah blah blah. But I did read this one a little bit more carefully. I still skimmed Reddit, so maybe it's just fresh in my mind. But there are some clear statements about modifying the game and distributing altered versions of the game, different levels or different scenarios. I kind of get the impression that if this didn't exist before, then it is a pretty strong swipe at the likes of Team Fusion in their attempts with Team Fusion 5 patch, which does involve a different tether and does involve some different aircraft and effectively does change the level or the scenarios within IL2 Cliffs of Dover. And this does indeed fly somewhat in the face of what the family or the parenthood of IL2 has developed and morphed into. There's a different engine and perhaps a different studio, but I'm sure the same finances are behind Battle of Stalingrad and Battle of Moscow, both which are less satisfactory flight sims to me when I compare it to IL2 Cliffs of Dover. I think they've regressed back into some hybrid of arcade meets simulator, which takes, you know, it kind of fills in the gap between War Thunder, which is very arcadey, and a very basic first edition of IL2 Cliffs of Dover, which was, you know, as simulatory as it could be, if that's a word, but it was so broken you couldn't really get past arcade mode on it. So there's some interesting stuff that appears to be going on, and there's plenty of energy within the community that have highlighted their dissatisfaction with this patch, and some of the comments have kind of communicated quite succinctly what my reaction was, which is, where were you when it counted? You've kind of left this for 5 or 6 years, and now all of a sudden you come in and you're just messing around. What the hell? You know, go away. It's their code, they still own it, it's their license. You know, we buy a license for the code, we don't own the code when you buy a software product. So Flight Simulator X, I don't own Flight Simulator X, I just own the license to fly it. That's kind of what's going on with IL2 Cliffs of Dover. And of course on our little channel for 54 Squadron, the thread has started to get quite active, and there's quite a few messages going over and back as we've all kind of realized what's going on. Some of us are flying with Windows 8, some of us are flying with Windows 7, some of us are flying with Windows 10. So it's bound to affect some of us in some way at some point. We'll give it a couple of days and wait for the noise to die down a little bit, and then we'll understand a little bit more about what's going on. However, behind the scenes, rumor and suspicion and suggestion, ideas and all the rest are running amok. Could it be that, you know, there's something going on with those that own the license to IL2 Cliffs of Dover to try and mitigate basically the competition represented by what IL2 Cliffs of Dover is and could become with Team Fusion patches, compared to what they have in stock for their own new latest money-grabbing products, which are good simulators, I suppose, good games in their own right. They're just not really that exciting to me. They're overpriced for what they are compared to what IL2 Cliffs of Dover represents. You know, it's a bit like having a very nice, for instance, this Coronado 208. There might be another product that is comparable to this and maybe a little bit better in some respects and maybe doesn't have a few bits and pieces, and by and large it's essentially the same. It has a couple of features that this one doesn't have, but that's it. Yet it'll cost another $40 or something. You know, why would you feel the need to spend that $40 for a feature that you might use twice in your career, kind of flying it? In other words, you're good with what you have. You don't really need to jump ship. You're quite enjoying it. You like it. It does everything you want. You know, unless you have loads of money and you really have the interest, then there's really no value in that other piece of software. And why? Only because you got this piece of software first. Maybe it was out earlier or whatever. That's kind of how I feel about Boss and Bomb. It's not bringing anything to my flight simulation experience that IL2 Cliffs of Dover, as it stands right now, can't meet. Yes, it's a different theater, but I'm not necessarily interested in the Eastern Front so much. The aircraft, I'm kind of mostly interested in the aircraft that are in IL2 Cliffs of Dover anyway. So for me personally, it's kind of, I don't see any major motivation to jump ship. Naturally, that's my opinion, and that's only good for me. But anyway, this update, out of the blue, has raised some eyebrows and kept the threads fairly busy. Let's think sinister thoughts and assume the worst. Meanwhile, back in the plane here, we are flying at 159 kilometers, no, nautical miles, flying along at 9,500. We are heading towards Skips, and we're doing grand. We'll throw a turn in at Skips. You can see the magenta highlighting the leg that we're on. We open up the flight plan here just really quickly. We can see that we're going from Jinur to Skips. We have, what have we got? It's written over there. We've got 22 nautical miles to run. 19.2 nautical miles. Hang on. What's going on here? That doesn't actually make sense. The distance that's reporting there is 23.1. The distance remaining there is 18.2. From Jinur to Skips, those two numbers are not adding up to the same thing. Why is that? It's about a 2.6 kilometer distance or difference between these two numbers. Oh, I know why. This is in nautical miles over here, and I reckon I have it in statute miles over here. Yes, I do. Yes. Why would I do that? Well, anyway, that's the reason why there's a difference in number. That's in statute miles on the MDF, on the PDF, and over here on the GPS MDF, it is in nautical miles. So nautical miles and statute miles, there's a difference of a little bit. Anyway, ETA of 10:26 at present progress. And say, looking real nice out there. Fluffy clouds all around. There's enough kind of to maintain arguable VFR conditions. Skips is just up ahead. We've got that little island outlet. There's some options to land up there as well, which I shall have to go and check on a little bit later. We're just going to do a VFR landing straight into Nassau. We're not necessarily going to fly any approach or anything right now. I'm just going to kind of keep it nice and steady. Wind is going to become a little bit onto our front quarter, and that might slow us down a little bit once we make this turn in what is going to be another 11 knots. So that might change our ETA time ever so slightly. Fuel-wise, we are okay. Just about okay. Everything's okay down there. We've got 478 remaining. We've used 205. We're fairly balanced in the tanks, so no big drama there. Papa's running at 1900, which is a nice number. And we've settled down to 1780 on the torque as well, so we're definitely not putting any stress on the aircraft running along here at 160 knots. That's fine. That's okay. We could run a little hotter, I suppose. But this is going to be a good enough reference for what I want to achieve. Fairly impressed with my FPS up here now. Also slightly confused as to why it's so good. It's actually reporting 93 frames per second, and I don't know why that is. I don't think FSX Original, running on an i5-3750K, with the various sceneries that I've downloaded, including this Carinata aircraft that I've downloaded, is capable of running at 92 frames per second whilst I'm recording. But it all looks very smooth. Just look at that cloud as it passes through the side of the glare shield. There's not really an awful lot going on in terms of stutters or anything. I'm not complaining. I just don't understand why it's so good. I really don't. But anyway. Yes, the FPS is going to be a little bit better because we're up in the sky here and there's not an awful lot painting in. There's Rex Weather being used here as well, by the way. So, you know, there's plenty of stuff going on. Once we get overland and into populated areas, that number is going to go down. We're beginning our turn. We should see our right wing drop pretty much any second now. There we go. We'll have to kind of see how things are going, but I'm kind of looking at that FPS number thinking, yeah, I like that. Actually, we haven't started turning yet. We're just about, there we go now. Okay. Main island is going to be just kind of the other side of that cloud down there, at 3 o'clock. And we're going to level out here and head over in this direction. So our next waypoint is Prune, is it? No, it's Woozy. Then we have Prune. 30 knots to go, then 43, 28. Fair old bit of distance. Wind now is coming straight in off of our 3 o'clock. So that's going to keep us... we're able to keep up with it. It's actually full on. It's only half strength with that factor, but it's kind of going to be pushing us a little bit off course, so we're going to have to kind of crab a little bit into it. Various little artifacts down there, which I don't understand. Kind of islands that don't seem to have any profile over the water. The water looks quite carpety. One thing that I am not running is water on very high, you know, very, very high settings. That maybe I have a little bit of headroom that I could bring the water back in a little bit more. I don't tend to be looking down at the water all that much anyway, so it's okay. I don't mind. Stable on the speed. We've turned on the skips towards Woozy, so we're looking okay. I don't really want that. And yeah, we just ticking along here. All very nice. I have north up here as the option. I thought I had set that to track up at one point in time, but I like north up. It's something that I can operate with. I know other people want track up because then, you know, if they look out the left of their aircraft, they kind of, it corresponds directly with what's on their screen. And that is very logical. Absolutely very logical. Completely understand that. Yet I'm not doing it. Because I like kind of to reference against north. I guess I always have. And it's kind of what I'm used to, so there isn't a right and wrong. There's a better for you and a less good for me. But you know, that's kind of what it is. I know that north is out that way generally. And that we're heading kind of easterly in a general direction. We're actually heading easterly with a bit of south of a component in there. But I can tell that because we're doing 121 degrees track as opposed to 90, which would be east. Yeah, see? Skips to Woosie, 26 standard miles remaining. Stable with 9,500 feet at 100 and just under 160 knots, arguable. So we're ticking along here fancy. Few clouds that we're going to bounce through here, and they're kind of just going to graze us, really. 38 minutes on the clock, so we're not doing too shabby. Like I started with this video, all this information is going to get pushed into our general aviation schedule, or schedule. How do you pronounce that in your country? And we're going to build up quite a few flights, which will ultimately provide plenty of GA flying opportunity for the folks in our Knox Vegas Airlines virtual airline company. The other side of the business, the virtual business, all of this is virtual, have us flying A319s and A321s. I believe that there's some Boeing aircraft about to join the fleet. We also have a TBM 850, or a couple of TBM 850s in the fleet, which we'll be adding some routes for fairly soon as well, once we kind of go through and prove these. So by and large, this is all going to add up to our pretty nice selection of routes, different aircraft that people can use, and a nice split between general aviation and high and fast. I'm quite interested in the airline kind of stuff now. I've kind of pottered around with my own style of general aviation flying, as you can see here, for quite some time, and I quite enjoy it. There's plenty for me to learn, and there's quite a few areas that I need to develop in. But I am able to get from point A to point B with some kind of degree of sensibility. Sensibility is not the right word. Sensibleness, if that's even a word. But it is with some attraction that I'm looking at flying the bigger aircraft now as well, and getting into standard instrument departures and standard terminal approach routes and whatever else those things are called. You know, working the FMCs of the flight computers, and ultimately getting into some VATSIM air traffic controlling at that level, and you know, being able to fly on a fairly busy night and stay ahead of the aircraft, that would be where the goal is. Right now I can take the aircraft up and fly around, but I'm not necessarily doing it properly. I'm still learning. I did buy the Aerosoft Airbus bundle, so there's the 318, 319, 320 and 321 aircraft bundled into there, which was, you know, which is good. I have subsequently realized that FS Labs are bringing out their aircraft as well, but the price difference is fairly significant. I think you're getting a lot of bang for your buck with the Aerosoft product, and I think the FS Lab product, which has been on the you know, on the approach for quite some time. I think it seems to be delivering quite a solid product in terms of its fidelity. Based on the few videos that I've seen at this early stage, it's the 23rd of August and it's actually not in wide public release yet, but I think there have been some copies sent out to the more active YouTubers within our community, you know, and they're doing reviews and obviously stoking up a little bit of interest. It's part of the whole marketing plan of the modern world now, to leverage community leaders effectively. So I've been checking out some of those, and it comes across to be quite interesting. But it also shows that the Aerosoft product is quite a competitor. The install base is significant. It's been out for quite some time. The Aerosoft product has received a number of updates as well to address some of the bugs and the problems that it suffered from. So I don't think the Aerosoft product is going to disappear. And the price point between the two, there's a significantly more expensive option if you're choosing the FS Labs. So you can still get a lot from that aircraft. And if you're kind of entering into the market for an Airbus 320 series, then you know you do have. You do have a little bit of research that you need to do. You will have to stick your hand deeper into your pocket for the FS Labs model. But you may feel that that's worth it in your case. Each to their own again. And I think that's great because there's different price points in the market and different products that will suit different people. For me, the Aerosoft product is already ahead of me and I'm playing catch up to it. And so far from what I've seen within the FS Labs, it's, you know, there's not an awful lot there yet for me to see the difference in price, to be honest with you. I'm trying to not be judgmental here, and I am being judgmental and failing terribly. Excuse me. I think if I was coming into the conversation next week when this thing is released, it would be worth doing the compare and contrast between the two via YouTube and via as many of the resources as you possibly can get. You might need to wait a little bit of time for the FS Labs model to find its way onto regular channels within YouTube so you can see for yourself, comparable to the existing volume of videos for the Aerosoft product. But I do think you're going to be looking to see the justification for the additional money. And I think it remains to be seen if it's easy to find that or not. I've already kind of picked my horse in this race with the Aerosoft products, and that's where I'm going to stay. I don't see the value in spending a significant amount of money again for effectively a product that is not going to offer me personally anything new just yet. Maybe in the future there'll be a reason to do that, but not yet. With the 747, I went straight in for the BDMG because that was what was on the market and it was well established. And I think BDMG as a reputation sits right up there at the very top, and I think it is the target for all the other companies to try and reach. But they're not lagging behind in the far distance, you know, kind of obscured by the dust of PDMG. They're each providing a fairly significant product in their own right. Right. Bladdy bladdy blah, and how far away are we from where? If we pull up this flight plan again, we kind of need to find ourselves getting over to Ford's Prune. That gives us 28 nautical miles with which to drop 9,500 feet. And I'm pretty comfortable that we can go and do that, so that's not too much of a drama. What I do want to do is drop down here to here and go to procedures. No, I don't want to do that. What do I want to do? I want to get out of there. Stop. Well, let's just go back and... That's already it, so we just entered that. And that's okay. If we go here... procedures like this, yeah, much easier. Do it the right way. Get down to select approaches. I said we weren't going to do this, but I'm kind of interested in doing this now. We can see what approaches are available. So Nassau International is what we're looking for. No. You great big Aegis. No, it's not NYNM either, you dyslexic fool. As opposed to whatever. We need to... That's fine. Enter. Entrez. Go down to here and then see if we can work out what air route we want to go in. ILS 14 kind of feels like a fairly sensible one. That brings us in here. So we can activate that, and this is a sequence of Huntex and then straight onto runway 14 basically, and then we have ZAO as our kind of get out if we're running into difficulty here. So I might activate that, or I might load it. We'll load it. Get down here. Get down. We don't want to do that. We want to load it. How does one load it? One has to activate it. Okay, let's just activate it then. This is turning us around. And this is the... Yeah, I don't want to activate this yet. Let's just carry on and fly there, and we'll do the approach once we get down to there. I do want to take that out of it, though. So let's go down one more. Wondering if we need to clear that out of it. Remove that. Yes. No, that was the wrong thing to do. You gobshite. You blithered an idiot. Let's enter that there. That's fine. And then let's just do the same thing as we did before. I know what I'm doing in this aircraft, don't I? I used to know this as well much better. Select the approach. Yes. And we'll activate it a little bit when we get closer to where we need to be. Not just yet. Because right now we're onto prune, and I want to get to prune, and then we'll activate. We have 30 miles still to go. So this is 15 minutes of a flight so far. Just turn off that procedure for a minute. You know what? Let's just activate it. Enter. Activate vector to final. Activate vector to final. Or activate ILS approach. Which one is it? Yes, activate. Why is it it's constantly telling me to activate? This is not right. Where are we going right now? We're here, we're there, we're everywhere, but I want to actually... We're going to HuntX anyway, so that's 51, so we have a bit of time to clear up this stupid thing. That's loaded is there. And we want to activate the approach at some point in time. Press the proc key to see the various page. Yeah. Well, that's fine. We haven't got to lapse yet, so we've done this way too early, basically, which is, you know, whatever. We'll just leave it for there. We have another 48 miles to go, and we're going in generally the right direction over here, so it's not too bad. The Garmin G1000 here from Carinetto, it's pretty good. There's a few little small things that are different to the Mindstar Aviation one, which catch me out. Most of it is just button pressing type stuff. I'm very rusty with it at the moment anyway, having not used it for years. So I'm kind of part of the problem for sure. But I have gotten used to the Mindstar Aviation one, and I kind of see some things in here that are just a bit different and a little bit different in an annoyingly so way. But anyway, if we do look at the flight plan again here and we close off that procedure, I'd really get rid of it for some reason, and I don't know why. I want to see the distance here, but I don't know why the procedures thing doesn't get out of the way. What's the button for doing this? So we're going directly here. We're on a heading of 141 degrees. We've got 36 nautical miles to go before we drop down, and then we have 7 nautical miles, 4 probably nautical miles to run in. So what this is saying to me is I probably need to start reducing my altitude here nice and gently. So I'm going to set myself down to about 3,500, and in terms of vertical speed, we're going to take it nice and gentle, so that we have plenty of time to get down. And then here we're just going to take a little bit out of it to compensate, so that we're not increasing altitude, airspeed all that much. Let's see how this thing will pay for itself. Estimated time of arrival is still around the 10:30 mark, so we're not gaining or losing any time here with all of this. We're still making decent enough progress, so hits the 160 mark as we pull ourselves down through the cloud. We still have a cold temperature there, nothing major going on. Darker, deeper waters here. Our airport is on the other side of this cloud bank over here. 500 feet per minute at 36, or what is actually 31 nautical miles. That should be okay. We need to lose 6,000 feet, and then we'll lose a little bit more in the last, so that's fine. We're also getting a warning that our fuel levels are getting fairly low, funnily enough. We're down to 160 pounds in each tank, so we're okay, but as I feared, there was always going to be a little bit of a, oh, we don't have an awful lot of fuel for doing anything, you know, additional. So what else do we have to think about here? 58 nautical miles to go, 211 total is what we're running here. We're coming up on the hour, so this is going to take a little bit longer to fly. Mind you, it is kind of... Yeah, actually it's going to be a good bit more than an hour by the time we're finished. In reality, we haven't been burning the fuel crazy. Running along relatively economically. We're down through 8,200 for 3,500 and another 27 nautical miles to go, so we're looking dandy here at the moment. 500 feet a minute drop, we have a little bit of wind at 34 coming up on us, so that's, you know, that's going to become more of a factor as we go in, but we will be landing into the wind. Kind of landing into a crosswind, really. But that's okay. Everybody okay back there? Nobody back there. So I'm okay on the fuel. It's giving the warning because we're down under the 200 pounds mark on each left and right wing tank. So... you know, something that it's telling us to be aware of, but there's no need to concern ourselves majorly because we have another 50 odd nautical miles of track to do and we have plenty of fuel to cover that. Continue working our way down and looking out over the glare shield here to see if there's anything we can recognize. Down through 7,600 now, so we're got another 3,000, shy of 4,000 to run. Excuse me, got another 3,000. What am I talking about? We have another 4,000 to drop. Jack, can't do maths. 23 nautical miles. Everything is looking fine. Just picking a runway and a procedure to go in. I guess what we would, in paper terms, have done is gone into our Nassau... into our airport list for Nassau, and we would have checked out the ATIS, and that would tell us something.
Nassau Airport Information Delta 1421 Zulu, wind 112 at 12, visibility greater than 20 miles, sky conditions clear, temperature 15.13, altimeter 2974, ILS runway 14 in use, landing and departing runway 14. Aircraft, say direction of flight. All aircraft, read back, hold short instructions. Advise control, initial contact, you have Delta. Nassau Airport Information, Delta 1421.
Okay, so we are kind of a little bit far away still to go and make that call. We'll get to about 20 nautical miles or a little bit less, and then we'll make that call for a full stop landing, but 14 is the runway that is in use. It should always is. I mean, you know, we're squawking VFR here anyway, so we'll just tell them, hey, we're coming in this way and this is what we're doing, and there's no other aircraft in the air anyway, because I think I have most of the traffic turned off. So we're holding steady at 161, maybe gaining towards 162 knots. 6,400 feet for 3,500, so we're doing nicely there. And we still have a little bit of a track that we need to travel, so everything is looking dandy. Probably could have leaned off the engine a little bit as we went up so high, but I haven't changed the mixture all that much. Oh, there's the outside temperature up there, and that gives me a outside temperature of in Celsius on the inside, Fahrenheit on the outside. It's pretty close to zero right now. And it's actually zero reported on there as well. No visual of land just yet, have we? No, not quite. We will expect to make a right wing downturn to pick our heading onto there, so at that point in time we'll begin our slowdown as well. Water looks kind of cool from this angle. The deeper water is kind of nicer. The shallower water is probably where you need to take a little bit more effort. Excuse me for yawning, as I always seem to be yawning in the evening. Come on back with me, fly in here. Well, we're over the hour and 3 minutes now. So we'll be closer to the hour and 15 by the time we get this down at this rate. But that's okay, 14 standard miles now. As we pass down through 5,400, another 2,000. 1900 and change left to go. Damn. So Huttex is there, which is fine. Punch through these clouds. Kind of interested to see if we're picking up any icing evidence or anything there. I don't know if it's modeled or if we can see it, but we are kind of just passing through these cloud layers. And aha! There's land. Well, that's a good sign. That's that lake area. The runway is to the south of it, so we're kind of heading straight for it at the moment. I think the runway is obscured just by that cloud in front of us, the leftmost part of it. Descent rate seems to have been relatively gentle and maybe timed not so bad. No, there's the runway directly ahead of us. But that's not runway 14. Yes, it is. That is runway 14. We're running 152 on there and 114 is 140, so that's her. Five from Monex. I'm going to stay with this just for a moment and see what we end up coming up with here. Because of the wind, we are kind of biased a little bit to the right of the runway as we look at it. We are being kind of pushed back and kind of in that direction a little bit. So as we get closer, that'll all kind of straighten up quite nicely. Another 7 nautical miles before we click onto there. And we'll be coming down onto it quite handy. We will start slowing down once we get a lot closer. Although we are getting into about, oh, what is that? 4 and 6 is 10, 11. 11 nautical miles from there. So, reckon it's about time that we're going to request a full stop landing and see what they say. Has us dropping down onto there, so that's going to bring us in fairly nicely. So we've got 3.5 to go on hood takes and then 4 in, so we're still a good 7 or 8 knots away from the runway, but looks like we're coming in handy enough. We'll begin slowing down a little bit, putting some flaps in. Incidentally, there is a little indicator on the flaps settings here, so approach flaps 150, takeoff and approach flaps at 150 knots, landing flaps at 125 or lower. So we're kind of getting down to 150 here right now as we're getting into our setup, and going to bring ourselves down to about 1400, I guess is going to be fine. Let's do that, because we're going to be high very quickly here now. And we'll just pull back on here quite a bit and start bringing ourselves down in speed. That's fantastic. We'll turn off the autopilot anyway fairly quickly, but what are we doing? We're 147, so I can drop in a run of knots there, and that'll slow us down and see if we can drop down even more aggressively. Take the power out. 125, we can throw in the last flash of our notch of flaps, and that's going to get us slowing down even more nicely. Dropping out of the sky now. So I'm going to turn that off and take over and hand fly. Kind of aim for about 90. We're very high, but we have our speed under control. Altitude is coming down at a fairly healthy rate of knots. Actually, we don't want to do too much more than that, but we do need to get it down. So as far as the glide slope is concerned and all that kind of jazz, obviously I'm not really doing much in terms of managing the glide slope. We have the yaw damper on. I am just going to turn the navigation off. That there, and we're just going to bring it in. Prop is set up to full. Landing lights, we'll turn them on. Mixture is okay, and 1100 feet. We would have set a barometer, our pressures, and everything else so that we'd be reading the right information. We're coming in on 90 knots here, which is fine. Still taking a little bit out of it. 600 feet now. I'm sorry, 800 feet. Still high. Puppies are showing all the colors that mean we won't crash into the ground too early. 149, so it seems that like 147 or so is 146 maybe is the actual runway heading for heading 14. And we're just kind of running in here. Still quite high. So the glide hasn't really been optimum at all. Shame on moi. But we might get a few change in lights now as we come back in. There's the first one anyway. And kill that. And kill that. We're bringing it down onto there. And bring the nose down. And we're nice and slow, so we don't need any reversers or whatever going. Exit runway when able. Well, I could have exited there, but I didn't really make the effort to slow down well enough. However, we have landed, so we are going to stop that at 1 hour and 13. Let's just take all this speed off and exit the runway. We're Vic. The runway. 121.7. So I just do it here, and I want to go to parking.
Cessna November 992 Bravo Tango. Taxi to General Aviation Parking. Via taxiway, Hotel Lima 5.
Hotel Lima. Thank you, ground. Hotel Lima 3. Assume that it's over here. If it's not, we'll have to go the other way. Shit, that was the wrong way to go. I've just worked it out now. Coming in from this runway here, this will be Lima 2. And so it is. Right now the ground controller would be saying, "Where the frickin' hell are you going?" To which I would reply, "Just having a look. We're going to do a fairly sharp turn here. And we'll go back." Well, now the rest of this video is not just going to be terribly exciting with me going the wrong way around an airport and taxiing, but essentially this is what we're doing. We'll turn off the strobe, turn off the landing lights, turn off those lights as well. Nobody on the board anyway, so it doesn't really make a difference. We're running along here. 20 knots of a taxi is a little bit too much. That's Lima 3. Lima 4. You're kidding me, it wasn't too far away at all. Well, that's Echo. Lima 4 is there. Lima 5 is just here, so not too shabby, not too bad. I do have the ability to get things right accidentally on occasion. So this flight has taken us 1 hour and 13 minutes in reality. And in terms of fuel used, it used 422 pounds of fuel. I don't think it really makes a difference where we park here, to be honest with you. I'm just going to run it up randomly here for the purpose of now. But the route makes sense. It does give you the options of picking up an approach, which we did, kind of. And it does, yeah, it does generally kind of work, right? So let's get her up to about there and bring her to a stop. And let's click on that. Put her handbrake on. And then we'll cut the fuel. And watch everything shut down. Nice. Got a little bit more of the turbine going there, but that's fine. We can turn off those things. Turn off that. Turn off the generator. Turn off that. turn off the batteries and turn off any lights that we had left on. We'll even turn that one off. Everything is back in full. We didn't bring our flaps up. That was a mistake. We've left the flaps down. We do have enough battery power to bring them up though, I think. So and there they are up. Alright, so that has us done, and that is the end of the video. So, thank you for watching. If you stayed with me, I hope you enjoyed it. It wasn't too boring. There will be more flights that I'll do over the course of time as I fly around in FSX, and hopefully I'll become a little bit more proficient. But for now, thanks for watching, and until the next time, go handy.